What are disease-modifying drugs? Disease-modifying drugs, DMDs, are also referred to as disease-modifying therapies, DMTs. They are a group of treatments for people with multiple sclerosis. Most treatments are for people with relapsing multiple sclerosis. They reduce the number of relapses you might experience, as well as reducing the severity of any relapses you do have. DMDs also reduce the buildup of long-term disability. Two DMDs for progressive MS are also available. Today we're going to be talking about disease-modifying treatments, DMTs, which can be a little bit of a confusing topic. For example, there's over 14 different treatments for relapsing MS and some for progressive MS coming to the market too. And we've seen a lot of MS teams move from the wait and see approach when it comes to DMTs to try and treat MS early. So we thought we would try and clear some of these questions up a bit. Today I'm chatting to Dr. Sharmilee Gnanapavan, who is a consultant neurologist at Barts Health. Hi, Sharmilee. Thank you for chatting to me today.
Hi, Helena. Thank you for the invitation. I'm looking forward to the questions you have for me today.
And I mentioned at the start that there's been a bit of a change in focus from wait and see to treat early. When I was diagnosed back in 2007, they were very much sort of say wait and see. But we hear now when people are diagnosed sort of this year or previous years that people are very much being told to go on treatment early.
Yes, so this is a change in the way we practice MS. As more medication options or treatment options have become available, that watch and wait policy has now become more in terms of treat early. Now, why do we want to treat early? It's all a matter of neuronal reserve. So we know that brain atrophy is a progressive thing, even with aging. And as we age, it progresses quite rapidly. With conditions like MS, which affect the actual brain neuronal content and neuronal reserve, this is going to be occurring at a much faster pace than with normal aging. So you need to really get in there early with the treatments. So in terms of clinical efficacy, if you go in early with DMTs, you're going to have better impact in terms of disability progression. Whereas if you wait, you have less of a neuronal reserve on which you can impact on. So with the availability of all these options now, it becomes, it becomes easier, and also it makes sense to just start treating now.
So if you were told like a few years back to wait and see, and you have maybe not sort of been in touch with your MS teams since, should you actually be asked to be seen again now and start talking about DMTs?
Yeah, I completely agree with that. I think, you know, as I said, times have changed and really things need to be current in terms of managing your MS. So if you are having ums and ahs about whether you're not certain if the disease is well controlled, I don't think there's any harm with just making an appointment and finding out for yourself whether you fit that wait and see policy still.
We sometimes hear people who've been told by their neurologist or their MS teams that they're too well to go on treatment. Should these people still sort of open up the conversation, or should they sort of accept that what they've been told?
Interesting question. What is too well? I mean, if you have a neurological disorder, in my opinion, there's no such thing as being too well. There's always subclinical symptoms, good days, very bad days. So if you really look at it, a person with MS under a microscope over a year, you find in fact they do have subclinical disease activity, which they've learned to ignore or are not picking it up as well as they should be. So I think, you know, with the development of new treatments, there are now new ways of looking at an MS person as well, through in terms of MRI lesions, brain atrophy, also now the introduction of CSF neurofilaments into clinical practice. This kind of just simply being well is now made more granular in terms of understanding the person a bit better. So you need to be more personalized in actually figuring out what the underlying pathophysiology in you is. Mm. And by looking at the biology of the disease in yourself, you may find you may be doing too well compared to others, or you may not be. And I think as science has moved on, so does the clinicians managing it, and so do the patients. They have to move on with it.
Yeah, because I think it can be sort of a frustrating thing to be told that you are too well if you are feeling, you know, you are feeling you're having symptoms and you're having really bad days. But then if your MRIs is showing that there's nothing new going on, but that doesn't mean that you're feeling well.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. And it's like, how long is a piece of string? And the more deeply you look into the disease pathophysiology, you realize actually there are changes happening. It's just not being picked up by instruments which aren't sensitive enough to pick it up.
Now, we mentioned that there was, for relapsing remitting MS, there's 14 different ones, and there's more, you know, DMDs coming onto the market. So obviously, when you sit down and try and make a choice, it can be a bit of a tricky thing. So what are your options around sort of escalation versus induction, i.e. like starting with a less effective DMD and switch when your MS becomes more active, or should you start with a sort of more effective one from the outset?
So this is based on person preference and really picking the correct individual for the correct treatment. In terms of the two types of treatment, induction therapies are generally front-loading of the risk. So they're high-efficacy drugs, but higher efficacy at the start. And the risk then lessens because you're giving just 1 year's worth of treatment and then you monitor. With maintenance strategies or maintenance escalation strategies, you are increasing the risk by swapping higher and higher. And you also have to contemplate what has preceded before and cumulative risk. So if you've had, for example, if you're treated for your MS almost 10 years ago, where you would have received mitoxantrone, which is now no longer used or only used in very specific cases, you may not want to follow it up with natalizumab because it compounds the PML risk. So there are these things which need to be contemplated. So in many ways, for a person, also lifestyle matters. So if you are young, you're in employment, you want a medication which is going to have the least impact on you. So an induction strategy, which then you can say, I'd have 4 years disease-free, that's 4 years of your life. You can just go around and doing whatever you want to do. So there's lots of things which go into deciding which one. The caveat to all of this is that the more you swap treatments, the least efficacious they become. So you need to find the correct one, which is going to work for your MS right at the beginning. And that's always a tricky business. I mentioned before that in Bart's Health and in other centres around the UK and around the world, you see CSF neurofilament. This is a marker of neuroaxonal damage. And we triage those into highly active and those who are not so active in their MS using that as a certain cutoffs based on age reference values. And those with highly active MS, we tend to go for higher efficacy drugs, mostly if we can use it, induction treatments. Whereas for those who are not, who don't have elevated neurofilaments or within the normal reference range, then we may say you may want to consider the platform treatments and a maintenance escalation strategy and not have to contemplate the risks associated with the higher efficacy treatments. So there's lots of way of doing this, really.
Yeah, and it really needs to be sort of the individual. There's not one size fits all when it comes to these things.
Exactly, yeah.
So not to go on to disease-modifying treatment is obviously also an option. Is there anything you could advise for people who have sort of made this choice?
So it's important to reevaluate your disease on a regular basis. And when you choose not to go on treatment, it's not necessarily going to remain that way all the time in every scenario. So reevaluate it, I would say, every year. There are now ways of monitoring your disease activity, lots of apps which monitor it for you. And if you find that there is a problem, you may want to make an appointment and reevaluate the entire disease course again.
Mm. Yeah, it's important to know that you can change your choices, can't you?
Yeah.
It's not like you made the choice and then you have to stick with it.
exactly. You know, it works vice versa as well.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. So at the moment, there has been a lot of talk about stem cell transplants and HSCT. We're getting a lot of questions about it. Should this also be sort of considered an option when it comes to choosing treatment?
Yes. So you might have heard the term that autologous hematopoietic stem cell transplant, which is a mouthful, but that's what HSCT, you know, says, is probably the closest to a cure you're going to get with MS disease modifying treatments. I think it is probably the ceiling of what is available for MS. Mm. And for those with highly active MS, which is not controlled by the best standard treatment available, whether it be natalizumab, alemtuzumab, or ocrelizumab, then they should be considered for AHSCT.
And do you refer people?
There is something called the Pan-London HSCT group, which reviews all the referrals case by case basis. You know, I've had luck with some, not so much with the others. And it's a matter of they are triaged based on what is felt to be most, whoever's going to most benefit from the HSCT. Now, I've had patients have it done privately as well. And so there are different ways in which my patients have had it done. I've supported all of them really in their decision process. And I've followed them up since then as well.
It's interesting to watch the sort of progress with this one. Do you think that there will be sort of move to treat progressive MS with HSCT as well?
Yeah, so interesting question you raised there. So the current data actually suggests that it's not effective in progressive MS. So the MIS study, which everybody seems to quote, shows that when used in relapsing remitting MS, compared to standard treatment, it does reduce the risk of progression by 20% as opposed to 80% with the standard treatment. However, in progressive MS, it hasn't been found to be as effective. So what they found out was that disease duration matters, the EDSS score, the disability level at entry matters, and whether you have active disease matters. So this is the way to think of HSCT is a very highly active anti-inflammatory treatment option. So you have to demonstrate some form of inflammatory activity to really benefit from it. There are risks associated, which are very much long-term with HSCT, which needs to be factored in when you try and balance these risks and benefits out.
And speaking of progressive MS, if you are being told that you're progressing and your DMT is no longer helping, what should you expect to be happening next?
So what does it mean when a DMT is not helping, really? I mean, you need to look to see, is there demonstration of inflammatory activity? If there isn't, then we need to consider other forms of treatment. At the moment, there's multiple clinical trials which are available for progressive MS, some of them quite innovative. And I would say that if your doctor hasn't thought about it, you should be asking to whether you can be referred to these studies. So some of them have been come back positive on phase 2 studies and are going into phase 3. So it's definitely no longer where things don't work. It's more interesting to see where these will evolve in the phase 3 analysis. So something to look out for, I would say.
Are there more treatment options coming for progressive MS?
Yeah, most definitely. So if you look at the licensed disease modifying drugs, there's one for primary progressive MS, which is ocrelizumab. So active primary progressive MS, i.e. demonstration of inflammatory activity. Recently, siponimod or mazen has been licensed for active secondary progressive MS as well. So I think these are very much turning points in the management of progressive MS. You must remember also that traditionally we used to use the mitoxantrone for those what we call transitional MS, so those who are progressing and quite rapidly, so the disease changes from relapsing remitting to progressive, and that worked well as well. Now I think probably the unmet need is what we call the non-active progressive MS, so those without demonstration of inflammatory activity, and that's where really there's a gap there. And I think the investigator-led studies which have been performed around the world are really filling that gap, and one of the ones which has shown a positive data is the Ibudulus, which is an anti-inflammatory treatment at the phase 2b level, I think, which showed reduction in confirmed disability progression just under 50% in the secondary progressive MS group. So this is now going on to a phase 3 study, and it would be interesting to see if that positive readout really pans through. Recently, I don't know if you've heard, but the BTK inhibitors, the bruton tyrosine kinase inhibitors, are being trialed in secondary progressive as well as primary progressive MS, and these target B cells in terms of their activation, but it seems that they may target microglial and astrocytes, which are what we think causes slow burn neurodegeneration in MS, which leads to disease progression. So it'd be interesting to see what we get from those sets of studies as well. If I remember at the last count, there's four pharmaceuticals who all have BTK inhibitors at various points in development for progressive MS. So interesting.
So there's definitely a lot of things happening in the world of research. And I take that will be sort of within the world of both relapsing, remitting and progressive now.
It depends. I mean, anything which is applicable in progressive MS can equally be applicable in relapsing remitting MS. I know from Bart's health, we've looked at subcut cladribine. So this is Professor Klaus Schmierer doing a chariot MS study, a phase 3 study looking at this, where we know oral cladribine or cladribine tablets work in relapsing remitting MS, but this is being now trialed in progressive MS. We ourselves are doing a very novel treatment trial looking at anti-plasma cell drug, which is a first of its kind. So the hypothesis being that oligoclonal bands form once you develop MS, and these are antibodies which are constantly being churned into your brain and spinal cord in the spinal fluid. And so if we can target these plasma cells, which are producing the bulk of these, then that may be another potential mechanism which can work at relapsing remitting as well as progressive. So depending on how well they work, I suppose you could probably shift it straight up to relapsing remitting MS and potentially prevent the development of progressive disease.
Well, that would be amazing. Yeah. So it's always great to hear how much is being done in the world of research when it comes to these things. Really gives you hope for the future. And I think especially when it comes to progressive MS, because it's often a field that's been very neglected when it comes to disease-modifying treatment.
Exactly. But I think it's going to change. So, well, it's changing already, as I've already outlined. So let's see what we get.
That's really wonderful. So any final advice for people who, after hearing this chat, might want to sort of open up the conversation? They might not even spoken to their MS team for a while, or they haven't spoken about DMDs, or indeed they could have been one of those people who've been told that they're too well. How do you open up the conversation to start treatment?
Well, approach your neurologist, approach your MS nurse, and say, look, I want to reevaluate my disease. I want to learn more about what the disease is doing to my body. I want to see if I'm at the correct trajectory, i.e. am I safe from progression? Is there a way of I can change that? It's not all about disease modifying treatments. There's a lot of lifestyle changes. Exercise, for example, really modifies disability progression. So it's best to just make that appointment and have that discussion.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for chatting to us.
And, no problem.
Hope lots of people will have something to think about.
Thank you very much, Hannah.